Okay, if we go back, sorry, Hannes, I apologize. These things come back when you're talking. We did an op with Colin Willis. The call signs involved were Koos Lutzer's call sign, Frank Vivier's call sign, and then Colin Willis as the main assault group, Bruce Fraser. I was in Bruce Fraser's call sign at that time. It was on the road from Chioko to Tet, and what had happened was that Bruce Fraser had free-falled and done a halo jump in with, I can't remember the other members who were with him, but three of them had gone in to go and do a forward recce on a suitable ambush position on the road. And then the main group jumped in afterwards. We all jumped in by Dakota at night. They called us in. We had to walk probably about 25 k's to the location where we were going to set up the ambush position, because Chioko was always a hotbed of activity for ZANU PF to stage from. And they were using trucks to ferry their guys from Tet down to Chioko and then from Chioko to our border. So, and they would come in via Motoko, as I understood it. Now, we jumped in and we carried everything that we needed. And we had to walk for 2 days. We were very heavily laden. And unfortunately, on the jump in, Jaws McClagan, who was quite close to me coming out the aircraft, who was carrying a rose mine, the deck had gone off and set the mine alight when it hit the ground. And it burnt. The plastic explosive burns very quickly and very high temperature. So his whole pack burnt. And that was the start of this op, which we thought we might have been compromised because of this huge fire. But it was decided that we could continue. And this was in October. And we walked across, I'm trying to think if it was 76. October 76, I think, Hannes. But we need to go back in the records to get the accurate date. And anyway, we arrived in the position, and funny enough, the PTI, Frank Hales, had joined squadron. He used to be Brit SAS and obviously hankered to get back into the action. And this was his first op back with us. He was a lovely character, but a lot older than us. So it was, although being extremely fit, it was quite hard work for him, I think. And anyway, we made our way to our ambush position. Frank Vivius was an early warning, plus minus 2 k's away. And Koos Lutzer's call sign with Bates Maria and them were based on the mountain, approximately a kilometer down the road from us towards Tet, to give us early warning from that side. And it was absolutely an ideal ambush situation, whereby the road was a dirt road and it dipped down plus minus 3 to 4 meters into a donga and then climbed out the other side. So now any vehicle would have been caught in this position, would have been, you know, we would have been able to destroy it very easily. But as it happened, we were in our position for 5 days. Nothing had come past. And then Frank Vivius on the Chioka side, with his call sign, picked up enemy walking down the road. And there were, I think, 23 or 24 of them in a group coming. There were some of them that were armed, not all of them were armed. And it looked like they were transferring people that had seconded in Zimbabwe from the tribal trust lands. And these were new recruits, which they were taking back to Tet. They probably would have been picked up where the road met the main Tet George's Road and taken from there by vehicle. But as it happened, it made an ideal ambush scenario for us. And Bruce Fraser and myself had been tasked to go across the road and lie in the ditch at the top of the hill, the incline. And this lot came walking down the road. And the guy in front, the first one in, was about 25 to 30 meters ahead of the main group. So he was quite fit and had a big bundle on his head. And when he got to the top of the hill, approximately 5 meters from us, he put it down and sat on it and looked at the others and basically was mocking them, saying, "Oh, look at me, I'm, you know, what's wrong with you guys? Keep up," you know, kind of thing. Bruce and myself could just see them against the wall of the embankment. Now, our guys were positioned all along the embankment. There were 10 in that position. And Bruce Fraser was tasked with shooting.
Initiating
it. Yes.
Yeah.
And I had the RPD. So as this guy turned around, picked the bundle up and put it on his head, he looked straight into Bruce Fraser. And Bruce shot him. But he fell, dropped his bundle, fell, and got up to run. So I shot him and I fired into the group that had now moved in against the embankment. They didn't know what was going on. They had never expected this ambush. The one enemy combatant was obviously an old soldier. He had that Chinese rice flick camouflage. He had a folding butt AK. And for the first time, I saw AK rifle grenades in a backpack on his back. So he must have been a senior guy who was leading these guys. There were two Frelimo soldiers in amongst them, and then another senior soldier at the back, and one senior soldier right at the back. We killed, of that group of 24, in that ambush, 19 immediately. Three turned to run. They ran down the road, foolishly, back into Frank Vivier's, of course. One of them, who hadn't been shot, was lying in the long grass in the riverbed. And Bruce Fraser and myself walked down clearing the road while we were covered from the embankment by Colin Willis's group. And one of the enemy jumped up out of the grass and said in English, "What's going on?" So I shot him because I didn't want him to get away. But thinking in hindsight, we should have captured him. But it was instinctive. We heard the contact on Frank Vivier's side. Actually, what had happened prior to that, though, just to sum it up very accurately, was a local on a bicycle had come through the ambush bush position 10 minutes before these guys, and he had a cooked chicken on the back of his carrier. And he got as far as Kostlutza's side, and they opened up on him, but they never hit him. He took off, left his bike, and he ran.
With his chicken?
No, we got the chicken. And it was lovely. It was peri peri Portuguese chicken. It was lovely. You can imagine, you know, at that time you're quite hungry, and you know, so it went down very well. It was smashed in about 2 seconds. But we went through the bodies, just making sure that no one was left alive. And then Cy Hartley arrived in a helicopter to fingerprint these bodies and try and get some detail off them. But I went up to this one that had run away, that our guys had shot from the embankment, who was obviously the guy senior in charge, guy in charge. And he was immaculately dressed, immaculately, his kit and his uniform, and he had a floppy hat, a big floppy hat on, bush hat. So he must have been quite a senior guy. I never found out who he was, I must admit. But for Colin Willis, that made his SAS career. That made his career. There's no doubt about it. Because it was so successful. We then cleared the ambush area and left all the bodies there because they'd done the fingerprinting and decided there wasn't anything to gather. There was no real paperwork as such on these guys. So they left. We were then instructed by Bob McKenzie to continue on towards the Ted George's Road and see if we couldn't put in another ambush down that road. So we walked for about 10, 12 k's down that road. And we were then told that there were two brigade strength Frelimo divisions coming down the road with heavy weapons and tanks. Because they'd now obviously heard the locals that reported all.
Yeah.
This was 2 days later after the ambush. And we were positioned on the side of a hill next to the road. So Bruce Fraser and myself were sent down forward of the road to see whether we could see where this main group were and where they were coming, because we could see a long way down the road, approximately 2-3 km down the road. And initially we were there for about 4 hours and we saw nothing. And then all of a sudden I saw two armed guys, plus minus 1,000 meters away. They'd obviously walked up through the bush, not on the road, and that's why we hadn't seen them up until that point. And I told Bruce Fraser out there, look there, there's two of them, they're both armed, you can see it. But he couldn't see, he was behind me. So he stood up with binos and they saw him and they ran. Anyway, we were told to come back to the sleep-up position where Colin Willis was with Quislutz and Frank Vivias. Frank Vivias was then dispatched along the mountain range to hold a position there. Quis, as the old soldier, and Colin Willis was very fortunate that we had Quis there, basically said to Colin Willis, we've got to withdraw from this position. And looking down into the riverside, there were deep erosion furrows cut into the ground. And we went down into those, because you couldn't see anybody if they were down there. Mm. They were at least 12 foot deep. So we walked along these as a group. And we'd been there about an hour and a half, and all of a sudden the mortars started raining down on our previous position. Yeah. So it was quite interesting, you know. We were obviously by this stage at least nearly 2 km away from that previous position, but they didn't know that. And based on that, then a commercial twin engine looked like a Beechcraft flew overhead. Not our planes at all, I think it was originated in Mozambique. And they fired 3 Strelas at it. But they didn't, they'd obviously panicked and hadn't given it time to lock on. And this poor pilot started dodging all over the sky and they didn't get him. Yeah, a lot of rifle fire and gunfire. And that's when we realized, well, this is severe, we've got to get out of here. Anyway, Frank was recalled and he managed to make his way down to our position. And Mackenzie sent the helicopters to pick us up, and we went back to Harare. Yeah.
And Barry, the story getting France out of tech?
Yes, okay. We were at very short notice. A squadron had just come back from, myself, from Mabalahuta, where we had been teaching recce. They hadn't been exposed to bush war at that stage. And their Colonel Blom, who was a very nice chap, felt that his unit needed to get some training from us, or operate with us. Let me put it that way, not training from us. I mean, I'm not going to be arrogant about this at all. They were good soldiers. So they just hadn't been exposed.
Mm.
And the Russian front being the worst place to operate, they came to us. And we'd done probably 8 weeks there. Unfortunately, they came with the Angolan contingent, and the one had been killed. We'd done a couple of ambushes to Mozambique where we'd had some success, and then on retrieval we had just got the new bells, you know, that they'd bought from Israel, and their blade drops much lower because it's not 4 blades, it's only 2, and you must duck quite low running in to be picked up. And this guy ran upright, and the weight at the end of the blade caught him straight in the head, killed him. Anyway, we had finished our deployment there and we're back for R&R. And Chris Schillenberg had been doing a recce on a camp just on the other side of the Zambezi, close to the Kutakota Narrows. And it was a very well hidden Zipra camp. They had taken blankets in place of bivvies and plastic, and used those as their structures to sleep under, and they were very low to the ground in the thick bush, river on bush. So no one had actually been able to find this camp, and he had eventually, with his Martin Chukunov, found it. And it had taken them a while. So consequently, there were no Sulu Scouts troops to do any camp attack. At that stage, they were all deployed. So they asked Mackenzie if A Squadron could before we went on R&R. But some guys had already gone, and some guys had finished their call-ups, so we were quite depleted. And Mackenzie asked me whether I didn't know anybody who we could to make up the numbers. He said, yes, I said, I'm from France, I know. I phoned him as soon as I got back. He's at tech, but he's in B squadron. Mackenzie said, go and get him. So I had to go into the tech in my SAS uniform and pull him out of class, which was which caused a huge ruckus. And said to him, listen, you know, would you be prepared and can you come? And he said, yeah, he's there. So I went back, and it was very, very short planning. So RLI 3 Commander, I don't know if you remember Bloodnut, okay, an old soldier. He was a sergeant in charge of 3 Commander guys. They took the one section of the camp, and then there was a Zambian army camp up the road, and Kurs Lutz's call sign was put in charge of ambushing them if they came into the contact area. But you would have to see the bush to understand it, Hannes. You couldn't see further than a meter in front of you. It was that thick undergrowth on the Zambezi River, right on the river. On the river itself was huge reeds, you know, those reeds that grow right on the river. So we fortunately didn't have to jump in. They took us by chopper and they dropped us in right on the camp. Schulenburg directed them right there. We went straight in on top of them, had our contacts. We didn't have too much success, but RLI did. They actually managed to catch the main group there. Unfortunately, one of their guys was shot by an RPG-7 in the back. I don't know, there must be some record of it. It was quite bad. So they were pretty deflated. In the meantime, the Zambian Army Land Rover came down the road. And of course, Lutz stepped into the road. And as soon as they saw him, unfortunately for them, one of their guys had jumped off the Land Rover. Their Land Rover just reversed. He just left him, left the poor guy there. And the guy was kind of flapping his face with a hat, according to Chris. So Chris shot him, you know. I mean, it's the enemy, so that happens. But it was a very strange camp attack, because these guys had obviously dispersed into this extremely thick undergrowth as soon as the fighting started. And then they were trying to escape by walking along the riverbank, and we would see the reeds move. So we were all positioned like up on the hillside of the embankment, overlooking this. And we were spread well out along it. So every time you saw that moving, we shot in there and then we would have to go and clear it. And so we were picking up bodies and stuff along the way. And it went on for most of the day. In the meantime, RLI were having their set up there, their punch up there. Then it all came to an end. And then Reed Daly, because it was actually a Salute Scouts op, there was a call sign operating in the valley who were all territorial guys, territorial force guys. The reason I know it is because my good friend Colin Clutie, who I went to school with, was one of them. There was Luke Corby. He was one of them. Anyway, they had asked Reed Daly, could they not join us? Because they'd never been exposed to combat. They wanted to feel this. They wanted to know about it. So he asked Mackenzie, and Mackenzie reluctantly said yes, and they came in. But they came in right at the end. We were basically, we had cleaned up. And now we put the arms cache together. There was a big arms cache, a lot of box mines. And Rogan Brown and myself were tasked to blow it. The rest, we're going to withdraw up the road. And the instruction that we received, and I'm not dropping anyone in trouble here, was that they would be on the left-hand side of the road. Now, in war, you need to be very precise to avoid these situations, because your left and my left are not the same left. Anyway, we packed everything. These scouts guys helped us, and they pulled out with Bob McKenzie and them up the road, and Kurs Lutz and them. And it was left up, and Terry Dawson, I think there was another one guy, to blow this thing. So we set the Semtex, gave us a good 10 minutes to get out of there. And we walked up the road, and I was at the back because I had the machine gun. And I just saw swing to his right and open fire. There was some shot with me, just backed him. And they hit Luke Corby and another scout's gun. They actually just about shot his leg off. I heard the screams immediately, and Colin Clutie jumped up right next to me out of the bush, and I realized it's a cocker. I ran forward and knocked the rifle down out of his hands to stop them shooting, because they would have shot all our guys, because our guys were not shooting back at us. They could see us, they knew, so they weren't going to shoot us, but we'd hit two of the scouts. And it was a disaster. The scout's medic kept biting the sausagon in half, because these guys were in extreme pain, and he had never been in this situation, you know. And Chris Lutz stepped forward and hit him, slapped him across the head, took the sausagon out of his hands, and injected it with their sausagon and some of his to calm the situation. And then, because we didn't actually have a medic with us in that particular camp attack, we never had a medic. Normally we would have had one of the medics, but it was such short notice. And we were all trained. We were all medic trained anyway. But it was a disaster. Yes, it was a success in terms of camp attack and all this, but it was a disaster when you have friendly fire like that. And it unfortunately happened more often than we would have liked.
Mm.
That isn't the only op that it happened on.
No.
Yeah.
Barry, let's just fast forward again then. To South Africa.
Well, do you want to hear about Kabora Bassa?
Yes, yeah.
Okay. So that was the other op. Sorry, Manana.
No, I do.
You know, we were, at that time, as I say, we were really flying in this war. And as I said to you earlier, virtually every weekend we were operational. But now, I don't know whose idea it was, but these cockleshell ops were proposed. So the first one happened with Bob McKenzie, Horst Lutz, Dave Berry, Pete Cole.
So it was canoeing on the
canoeing. Andy Chat, Billy Haynes. Okay. So they did the first one and had a tremendous time. And quite a few successes when you think of it, because you are a long way from help, you have no air support, and you're attacking whole towns. And they did. And got away with it, and did mine laying
clippers on Kabora Bassa.
Coming rode in on the Musungesi from Musungesi Mission, down the Musungesi, into the Zambezi at night, and then into Kabora Bassa. And there were many things that happened which were so unusual in nature. Like when they were when they were rowing down the Musungesi and the rapids there, the fish all started jumping into the clippers, nearly sank them. Because, you know, it's like crocodiles, I think, maybe chasing them all.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the incidences with crocodiles and hippos and lion and rhino were just unbelievable, you know. They had to be so careful where they slept up every night.
Yeah.
Then there were the issues in Kabora Bassa itself. And I'd like to tell you about the one camp attack that they did on the other side, on the far bank of the Kabora, on that town. And they went in there, initiated it, and what actually happened was the AA positions were on the mountain on the side, and they saw the gunfire happening in the town. They started shooting down into the town. They were shooting their own people. So this created pandemonium, and Billy Haynes and Andy Chait were against the building. So Billy was behind Andy, and Andy would peep around the building every now and again when the fire dropped, and he would shoot a couple of enemy and then pull back again, because he was fearless, Andy Chait. And Billy Haynes sort of stood back and waited, you know. Next thing, I mean, this is pitch black at night, but he feels this tap on his shoulder, and he turns around, and there's a Frelimo soldier looking at him with eyes this big. And Billy Haynes, I was speaking to Billy afterwards, all he said, he never shot the guy, he just said, "Fuck off." And this guy tore off down that road, and Billy ran the other way. But those are things, you know, that are humorous that happen.
So you came in after this?
We did the one after that with
also Colin, by Clipper.
Yes, with Colin Willis. So I was the senior sergeant, Dick Biederman, also a senior sergeant. Andy Johnson as a medic and also senior sergeant operator. Bruce Taverner, Graham, I mentioned his uncle's name earlier,
Taylor,
Graham Taylor. He was in my canoe. I couldn't think of how many people we had, but we were a fairly big group. Oh yes, Steve, Mike Pocket and Steve and his wife got killed at that fishing camp, your camp.
Schultz.
Yeah, she was Schultz.
Seward.
Steve Seward. Sorry, man. Sorry, Steve. I forgot your name. Sorry. Jan Marks was also there with us. In any case, we were dropped off with all our stuff with the choppers and then assembled at the bottom of Kabora Basa, right there by the Musangizi. And we put everything together and then we started rowing. But unlike the others, we didn't row at night. We rowed in the broad daylight. Colin Willis's experience was a bit, you know, he wasn't that certain of himself at that stage. He was a very good officer, but he wasn't that certain of himself. And I think that's why so many senior sergeants were sent with him, just to advise him.
Yeah,
not that we had that much to offer anyway. Mm. But the very interesting thing about Kabora for me, Hannes, was not so much the punch-ups that we had, although we had, was the clarity of the wood. The wood was so clear. You could see whole trees, I mean, and all the fish in the trees. You're rowing, and you see this underneath you. And the trees came out from the bank, over 2 kilometers into the dam, you know? And these, because the Portuguese had never cleared them, like in Kariba, they took bulldozers with ball and chain, and they flattened all the trees before the dam filled, but not at Kabora. And in these trees were millions and billions of spiders. And we would be rowing, and we'd row into them to keep undercover, and you bump against the tree, and all these spiders fall on your canoe. And we used to catch them. And then we, because we took fishing rods, because we knew it wasn't easy to resupply, and we're going to be there a long time. And we would hook these things, spiders on, and let it float on the water, and those big Mozambique bream would come in. You'd see them sucking, got you. And we ate like kings when we were there, really, it was really good. And so we were obviously tasked with the same operational sort of ethics of
lay mines
and attack strategic villages, more the aldementos, the old Portuguese aldementos. And we were there, I think, nearly 3 weeks, but it was fascinating, you know, because we'd never really come close to Kabora before that. And it wasn't inhabited. There weren't locals. There weren't many locals at all. They hadn't actually moved in there yet. And we obviously did a couple of attacks, which were and weren't so, they were fairly successful. I can't complain. But then we were told we had to go up and take out the town at the dam wall. But before that, we were on the other side of the dam. So we had to row up and then go across to where the town wall was. Yes. To where the dam wall was, basically. And unfortunately, this is where, as I say, the daytime rowing thing was not great trouble. But naivety at the time, you know. And we kept the one guy with us who knew the whole area there, and he rode in his dugout with us, and young Marks was put in charge of him that night. And myself and Dave Arkwright, Dave Arkwright and young Marks were together in the one canoe. He was a very good mine layer. So him and I went up and we laid the mine on the road into Kabora Basa itself. Then we withdrew and we went right round to the peninsula, climbed up the ledges to the top, our group, set our attack group, and then fired on the town below us, gave it a good revving. We then withdrew from there back into our canoes. In the meantime, young Marks had dispatched this other guy, and we got in our canoes and made for the islands. There's two islands in the middle of Kabora Basa, one big one and one small one. So we were going to the big island. And it had a lovely sandy bay there. But we didn't realize that Bruce Davner and Dick Biedemann's canoe, or clipper, was leaking. And it was quite rough. The wind was quite heavy on the water that night. So we were plowing through these waves. And as we got inside, the light, first light started coming up, and these guys were sinking behind us. And Dick Biederman never told anybody because he so badly wanted to go on the ob that he couldn't swim. So of all the guys, he was a guy who couldn't swim. He dived out of his canoe, he jumped out of his canoe and his clipper and grabbed the back of my clipper and screamed at me, "I've got to help, I've got to help him." He was in total fear at that stage. So the only thing that I think he was scared of, otherwise he was absolutely a brave guy. So I had to take action quickly. I said to Graham Taylor, "Right, I'm jumping out," because I was in the front of the canoe and Graham, being the bigger guy, was at the back and Dick was holding on to the back. So I said to Dick, "Right, you get in my seat." In the meantime, the other guys had come around Dick's clipper with Bruce Tamman in it to try and see what they could lighten the load and then get the clipper to the shore.
Yeah.
I swam then onto the island, because there's no use me hanging around in the water there. So, you know, there's crocs everywhere. So I swam to the island and then we managed to pull the whole thing in. And I said to Dick, "And really, what the hell are you doing on the softwood? You know, we could have had huge problems, you know, if his clipper had been hauled or anything." But yeah, so.
How did you get out?
Well, we rowed out. We fixed the clipper. We had all the kit to do it, yes. Yeah. No,
and you rode back. It's a long haul back to Rhodesia.
Yes. Yeah, no, we rode back and then called the choppers and the choppers picked us up and back again. But it was an unbelievable experience. I'm sure we've got pictures. I'm sure you might have seen Kabora pictures of the guy sitting in the trees above the water.
Yes,
you've seen
it. Yeah,
you can see Biederman sitting there.
Yes, I have seen that.
Yeah, Sandy Sanderson, I think he was one of the other guys. Yeah.
Very, I'm worried we're running out of
time. Yes, sorry, Hannes.
No, man. I'm
very
sorry. Such good stuff.
Yeah.
But I want to just...
The South African side.
Yeah.
Okay, sorry.
So
yeah.
We've got to...
One more up before...
Yeah, keep going. Yeah.
Sorry, Hannes.
No.
It's just maybe things coming back to me.
The South African side is so good. We can do it later.
Mm, okay.
Carry on with
okay, another op that we had to do. This new TF officer had joined us. I played rugby against him at Quickway. And I think he played eighth man for Rhodesia at some time. He was a new guy, and initially he went with Kurs, and they did a few ambushes on the Zambian side across the Zambezi. And we were based at Marna Pools at that stage, and it was right in the middle of the rainy season. Anyway, they'd heard about a camp there. It wasn't far down from the Chirundi Bridge, and we were tasked a course on a four, the officer, myself, Graham Taylor and Kevin Duffy, and we were told no packs, no backpacks, we must just go with our ammunition and a very light pack, very light pack, so that we could do a two-day recce, because it was ostensibly right on the riverbank in this extremely, extremely vegetated area. And the main road that ran to Chirundu was probably 500 meters from the riverbank. So we made all the prep, Kwis and them rode us across, we got out the other side, but the vegetation was just unbelievably thick, and we tried to push our way through it. It's at night, can't see where you're going. So I said to this guy, "Listen, we better sleep here until the first light so that we can see where we're going, because we're making such a racket. If this camp's here, these guys are going to ambush us. It's bad news. If we stop now, they might think it's game, you know, that's walking through your elephant or whatever. Let's just wait here." So we waited, we slept right there. We didn't have any sleeping bags or anything, we just lay there and waited. First light came up, just as it grayish like that. We get up and we start moving, and I saw the 15 meters away on our left hand side, squatting behind a tree, aiming at him. So I said to him, "Hey, shoot him, you're in front of me, shoot him." But I don't know what he was thinking, because he had this bright red hair. And he started doing this, as if come here kind of thing. Yeah. Ah, two. this enemy. And this guy just opened up. I saw him hit the ground. I thought he'd been hit. And because I was in position, the other two guys were behind me, behind a bush, and the rounds just came, tracer just came straight off over my elbow like this. So I drilled him. He fell back. I saw him fall back. Okay, so I planted two more into it. My concern was for this guy. because I thought he'd been hit. The way he fell, I thought he'd dead, stone dead. You know, when you see someone get shot in the head, it's just whack on the ground. So I grabbed him. Are you okay? Yes, I'm okay. But what we didn't realize was he'd hit the ground so hard, he broke his aerial off his A76, straight off. I turned to see where these other two guys were for backup, and they'd run all the way back to the Zambezi, because Kevin Duffy wasn't the bravest Okara. He was renowned for to run. So Taylor just followed him. So I had to run all the way back to the Zambezi, grab these two guys, and threaten them. You know, I told them, I'll shoot you if you run. Come. So we went back, picked him up, and then we had to get out of that area. So we had to call for a hot extraction to get out.
Jeez.
Yeah. Sorry, that was just one of the other things that we did.
No.
And we later went back there in another OP as well. And Kurs Lutz actually walked into the camp. And he walked into their first aid tent and took all their doctor's kit and stuff. And walked out, and they never knew. We went up the escarpment, and then, so that we could see down now, see where it was. But he went in, Kurs, and I think Davis Sullivan was with him, and they actually went into the camp because it was deserted basically. There were maybe a couple of camp guards, but at that specific time there was no one there. But it was fully kitted, it was already waiting for people to come. So they took some of this medical kit and stuff just to show, you know, when we came back. And the choppers picked us up from Ekam, and then we flew up the Zambezi, right up to the Kariba Dam wall, and up the Kariba Dam wall, and they landed us in Caribbean Bay. Oh, it was unreal. Sorry, Hannes, diverting.
Don't be sorry.
Sorry. We came down here. We initially, as I say, did this contract for Special Forces Futrika Wuchta, where we were based at Intembeni. And Lawrence Castain, myself, Dave Berry, Barry Deacon, these two RLI guys,
Beach
and Wessels, John Wessels, nice guys, really nice guys, honest. And then there was another one there who went with this other chap, Andy, who was a South African guy, and they had another camp.
So you were based outside Louis Trichardt?
Yes.
And you were under command of Johan Breitenbach?
Johan Breitenbach.
And you were going to be tasked to go back into Zimbabwe.
What they wanted us to do was obviously train these guys and then infiltrate back.
You had
Zipra and whatever.
Yeah. Fumar Bonin.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah. We had it anyway. And locals and whatever. It was a bit of a mishmash. Real rubbish bunch. One ex-Sulu scout, who Lawrence Castain recognized. Lawrence and myself never felt comfortable there. We didn't trust these guys at all. There was just a vibe that was wrong. And I think some of them were definitely spies for Mugabe. I really think that. But anyway, the SANDF demanded action. They weren't going to employ us and we don't do anything. So we started planning ops. Initially, the officer in charge was Daryl Watt's brother-in-law, Nick Huster. I won't say anything about that, but he was no use at all. And we then, in the meantime, I didn't know Daryl Watt was actually compromised in Wanky and was walking out of Wanky actually at the time. But we knew nothing about that. So we continued with our first op. We planned it. We sent Andy and this other RLI guy actually went and made contact with Zipra. And they ostensibly did an OP on this at Bite Bridge. They wanted us to blow up the fuel, bulk fuel setup. We then put our group together with these guys that we'd been training. And we walked across the Limpopo, went up behind Bite Bridge, and Lawrence Castain and myself were tasked with actually taking the train out. We were going to take the railway line and the train. We were just told we were not allowed to take any of the South Africa's wagons that they'd lent Zimbabwe. So anyway, we were in a big group. There were probably 20 plus of us. Dave and then John Wessels and Bob Beach were going to do an attack on the fuel stock storage setup, and they had 60 more mortars and RPG-7s and whatever. Lawrence and myself had two of these guys that we'd been training that we selected were pretty good, and they were going to come with us. But once we got into position, all of a sudden, Lawrence and myself were starting to move off the back of the group so that we could go and do our job. And the message came through that they'd walked into a big Zimbabwean army camp. So they called me forward. Dave trusted me. We operated many times together, many, many times hunts together. And I went forward.
Dave, very cool.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because he didn't know these other guys.
Yeah.
So he wasn't sure. So I went forward and he said, look, there, look at all the bivvies. So I looked. Okay, it's dark. But there was no movement. It didn't seem like they were occupied. So I said to him, no, come on. We're about 800 meters from the fence of the box fuel storage. And you could see the trucks filling up and everything at that stage. So I said, I'm going close. I'm going to walk through between these bivvies and see, is there anyone there? And they were all, and these black guys were panicking. They were shitting themselves, you know, because they're not used to this type of thing. Whereas we were, you know, we knew what we were doing. So I walked down between the bivvies and there was almost revolt in the ranks behind me. So Dave said, Baz, please come back, please. And Lauren said, no, Baz, you know, if they are there, we'll be caught between two fire groups. So I said, no, okay, let's leave it. What else can we do then? Because we couldn't now attack. We didn't have the range to hit the bulk fuel depot. Lots of activity going on. So we decided the main reservoir, which fills the shrouds of those tanks, because they're concrete, is filled with water to stop fire, that we must blow up the reservoir anyway and take out the main power station and then blow up the railway line.
And the locomotives?
Yes, no, not.
Not
the, they weren't locomotives when we got there. We were told they were there, but they weren't there. Okay. There were wagons, so we couldn't blow them up because they might be South Africa's wagons.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So Dave and myself cut a hole through the fence, through the security fence. We blew up the reservoir. We then went round to the power generating terminals and we did the same there. We blew them up and we blew up a couple of transformers. And then we went to the railway line and we planted two mines there. And then we blew up a big culvert on the railway line. And then we retreated back to Zimbabwe. I was very disappointed in the intelligence around it, the way it went. It was very dissatisfying, honestly, you know, in terms of amateurish operation.
Not long after that,
yeah.
Dave Berry goes with Beach and Wessels on.
Well, you see, we left it. What happened was we'd been there a while because we'd done all this training and our contract was for 9 months. And we were at the end of the 9 months and the others had all signed 3-year contracts, but we didn't. Lawrence and myself only signed 9 months because I didn't know. I wasn't sure. My family was coming, you know.
Just talk me through the Dave Berry.
Well, what happened was, you know, we then said, no, we're not signing on. And I went through to Pretoria with Ryan's to Breitenbach, who was a bit upset with us at the time. But the other officer with him was a guy from the Air Force, very good guy, very switched on guy. And he actually stopped Breitenbach because he was shouting at us. He said, no, wait. They have their reasons. We gave them a 9-month contract. It's finished. So, yeah, okay. And then Daryl Watt wanted me to do guard duty when I was supposed to move my family from New Chicago to Petersburg. And I said to him, take a hike, you know. Anyway, we had subsequently been offered jobs in Krobler-style farming, growing tobacco. And both of us knew how to do that. So we went there. But what actually happened was you had several new guys join that group. Rob Riddell, Rich Smith, but they weren't up to speed. But Breitenbach was looking for action. So Daryl Watt and them planned this op for Dave and them to go and do. And I'm not sure.
To blow up locomotives, rolling stock.
Yeah. But it was quite deep in, into the, right. So they were to take these blacks with them as communication with locals, because Zipro were quite a force in the area. And we had spoken to Zipro and they were actually good guys and they were on our side. But this is when I say these others, I'm sure there were spies in amongst them, because they had been in country about 2 days, I think.
They'd gone on the infiltration.
Yes.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, David sent two of them, more senior guys, to just get direction in a village. Now, after that, they got back and within outlets on this.
The Zaman era.
Well, that's what they say. Bob Beach got shot. John Wessels got shot. Dave picked Wessels up and carried him on his shoulder. And he had one of the black guys stay with him. The others ran. They just ran away. And ostensibly, on the way back to the border, so they say, there was an RAR sniper who shot Dave Berry. That's what they say. There is no proof. No one could prove it. I say they were shot by their own guys. That was the feeling I got. Maybe it's a false accusation, but I doubt it. How come every single black oak made it back across the river? The three white oaks are dead.
Four, was it?
Three. Three. Dave Berry, Bob Beach, John Wessels. Three. Bob Beach, highly decorated guy. I think he got a bronze cross or a silver cross. Years in Oralai. John Wessels, years in Oralai. Dave Berry, one of the best operators we had in SAS. You're going to tell me that those guys get killed and no one else gets a scratch?
Yeah.
Rubbish.
Hard to believe.
Very rubbish. I saw them when we did that one off. They were, as I say, just about revolted in the ranks when I wanted to walk through that.
A hell of a show.
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
No, it's an incident that people still can't fully understand.
Yeah. Yeah. Anyway, we went back. We went and farmed in Krobnestal. And unfortunately, the second year we were there, we had a major drought. Major drought. And the guy I was employed by just couldn't, he couldn't employ me, you know, there just wasn't any money. Couldn't grow any crops, you can't, you know. So we moved to Pretoria and Lee got a job with Doorbale, quite a nice job with Doorbale, and I was offered a position at breweries, South African breweries. We'd made friends with the engineering manager, Mike Smehager. And he actually got me in there.
Yep. Mary, just tell me what happened with Daryl, your understanding.
Where, in Wanky?
Yeah.
Okay, I sat and spoke to him for quite some, because we were still friends then. Well, friendly, you know, Daryl was a difficult character, but I always respected him. I always had great respect for him. I didn't have anything. I mean, we'd had contacts together. When in the southeast there, we were operating, that's more that I can talk about and tell you. You know, where I had a very successful contact under Watt, where we killed six, you know. Anyway, we when I sat and spoke to Daryl, he'd just come out and his feet were still bandaged and everything. And I said to him, what the heck happened? You know, why? And he told me that he was running a safari business in Botswana, but the South African government had sort of subcontracted him to go and OP ANC camps in the Panamatinga, Panamasui area, okay, on the Botswana border. And it's a very sandy area, and it's a lot of teak forests and that type of thing. So what he would do is he would take his clients out, drop them off in a game area, and then he would go and do his recce's, which was an ideal cover. But on driving to the, once he dropped his clients off and driving to the area he wanted to go and look at, his Land Rover became embedded in the sand. It was very loose sand. So he went to go and look for help, but he was close to this ANC camp. And he went off to go and find help. He couldn't find any help, so he went back to his Land Rover. Fortunately, he had taken a 9mm with him. And got back and it was surrounded by these ANC people. So they hadn't seen him. So he knew he was close to Wanky. So he decided to head for Robin's camp. And Darren, being a real bushman, he knew direction. He didn't need a map. He trucked off to get to Robin's camp. When he got there, the army were there, obviously searching for him. And fortunately, it was still white game wardens, and the guy saw Daryl and said, "Get out, get out. I'll come and I'll bring something for you." So he met Daryl in the bush, gave him water, gave him stuff, and said to him, "Look, you've got to get out of here. There's swarming with these guys looking for you." So Daryl discussed with the guy, "Well, what must he do?" So he said, "Well, look, I'll try and help you to get you close to Bulawayo. And maybe you can get hold of them to collect you to the, you know, South African authorities or whatever. So they went, Daryl got dropped off there by the airport, walked.
He got to Bulawayo.
And walked out by the airport and was dropped off well outside, but he walked to the airport buildings and phoned an ex-squadron guy to help him. But while he was phoning the guy, an SB, a white SB officer,
recognized
him. So Daryl put his hand on this 9-1, said to this guy, listen, you haven't seen me, and I haven't seen you, get out of here. And the guy knew they weren't, you know, so anyway, what happened was Daryl then, the squadron guy picked him up because he couldn't carry on phoning. So they buggered off to Nyamunchlaw. Then he brought Daryl back because the South African authorities said they would bring a plane and he must be at the end of the runway. So Daryl went and waited. The plane came but never landed. So now he was in cut. So now he managed to get hold of this guy again and the guy dropped him off by Wanky. And Daryl had to now walk all the way out of Wanky down to the Limpopo River.
It's a long walk.
Yeah, long walk. Now he had some very interesting stories to tell me about how the lions chased him all the way and he had to sleep in trees on the way back. And he had a 9-1, but halfway through, he met this old poacher in the middle of Wanky game pond. And they basically had a conversation. And this old toppy said to him, no, you must humber that way. I'm humbering that way. And the guy helped him, actually. Yeah. And he was, you know, so they buggered off. And Daryl got to Limpopo.
Yeah. How long was that walk? Must have been, that's a long way through that sandfield.
Hundreds of miles.
And dry country.
I can't believe he did it, but he did it.
His feet were stuffed when
he lost all his toenails. His feet were finished. He walked across the Limpopo, got picked up on the other side. And then they offered him a contract with us because he couldn't go back to Botswana. So he lost everything in Botswana. Fortunately, I think Gwen with the kids was in South Africa, if I'm not mistaken. So he accepted to come to.
And that's when he got involved.
He got involved.
Got involved in the whole
but we left, you know.
You'd gone.
We were gone.